Okay, good morning, everyone, and welcome to this week's Let's Talk Dairy webinar. So today I'm going to be talking about the proposed introduction of nitrates excretion bans, or an adjustment to the excretion or the excretion figures for dairy cows that's been proposed as part of the review of the derogation. And I suppose in reality, no matter what way we look at it, this is going to come into force, but it's not really going to be a matter of when it is going to come into force. And there's probably going to be a small impact on some people and a bigger impact on others, with approximately maybe 20 to 25% of herds in the country going to be affected significantly, I suppose, in reality. So I suppose just as a bit of context, I'll just show you the bans now. The department asked Chagask to look at these bans and look at the nitrogen excretion figures because milk yields have increased over the last number of years since milk quotas have been abolished, obviously. And we would be looking at a scenario when you just look north of the border here where there's higher nitrogen excretion bans for higher output cows also. So as a result, we have come under pressure from Europe through the department, obviously, that our 85 figure, which we had last year, wasn't sufficient for the output that we're beginning to generate now on a per cow basis. And this has had to be looked at again. So I'll just share my screen here now. So as I said, the department challenged our research colleagues to look at these figures again and come up with figures for them. So there's kind of no denying the science, basically. The figures are what they are, and they're going to be implemented. It's just a matter of when they're implemented. So as we currently stand, every cow in the country, no matter what production they're doing, since the start of this year, has moved to a figure of 89 kgs of nitrogen per organic nitrogen per hectare. And obviously that had some small impact as well, obviously going from 89 to 85, depending on how close you are to the 250 limit, maybe already could have seen a reduction in cow numbers in some farms or adjustments in order to tie in with them. Band one, there are approximately 15 to 20% of herds that are producing less than 4,500 kilos of milk every year. And they are going to fall into a category of 80 kgs of nitrogen per hectare. Whereas the vast majority, 65% I think, are in the category 4,500 to 6,500 kgs, which is the upper limit of that is around approximately 6,300 liters of milk per cow. So that one is going to move to 92. So basically, as I said, the vast majority of herds are probably going to be in that category. So there is going to be a small adjustment there. You're going to have a 3 kg increase in your organic N per cow and full of that adjustment. The one that's probably concerning a lot of people, concerns probably 20 to 25% of herds, I'd say, in total, is the span 3, where cows are producing more than 6,500 kgs or 6,300 litres per head. And their organic figure is going to increase significantly up to 106 kgs of organic N per hectare. So as I said, I think no point in really arguing about the figures here. The figures are what they are. It's going to be a case of when are they going to be implemented and what are people going to be able to do, I suppose, in terms of mitigating against them or managing around them or whatever way you want to look at it, okay? So I know from the submissions from the IFA and ourselves in Chagask that there has been two elements put into it from the Chagask point of view, in that it's difficult to plan for milk yield on a year-to-year basis, so that it should be calculated over a three-year rolling average, which would allow you to break the 6,500 kgs in a year potentially. And if you had a very good grass growing year and cows went really well, everything went really well, and you happened to go over 6,500, that you wouldn't be penalized by virtue of the fact that you'd have to suddenly reduce stock numbers or adjust land areas the following year, so that it would be calculated on a rolling average. And the IFA and ourselves are both in agreement in terms of the proposal to bring this in on the 1st of January 2022 is a bit short in terms of notice for to allow people to adjust to it, and that there may be a longer lead-in time made available to people to adjust to the new scenarios. So I suppose just to outline the current scenario, as I said, currently running at 89 kgs of N per hectare. 100 cows on 40 hectares, we keep our standard 2.5 cows per hectare. We're not going to really push the boat too hard in terms of stocking rate. And we're only looking at cows here for simplicity. Obviously, if we bring in the young stock into it, they're not being affected by the changes in the figures of excretion rate figures. they're continuing to be the same as what they were always, at 24 for a knot one and 57 for a 1-2. So if we do the 100 cow scenario on the 40 hectares, as I said, it's 2.5 cows to the hectare, not an excessive stocking rate, obviously stocking up during the course of the summer to cut your silage, etc. 100 cows, and this is obviously a very clean scenario because we're not accounting for, there's obviously some nitrogen produced by calves that are born on the farm and stay on the farm for a fortnight, maybe 3 weeks before they're sold, etc. And that all factors in, which is what makes it tricky to predict sometimes. So 100 cows by 89 kgs of N is going to give you 8,900 kgs of N per annum. And if you divide that by your 40 hectare land base that you're declaring, you're going to be at 223 kgs of N per hectare. So I suppose, what are the implications for that? Obviously, you're in a derogation situation there. So in order to retain our derogation, is going to be very important for this farm to be able to continue to farm at the level that they're farming. Okay, so that's our current situation. What is the likely impact of changing? As I said, the band one is going to drop to 80 kgs. So that's probably not going to be a huge issue. And I don't think it's probably going to affect a huge number of farms in positively or negatively, really. So it's going to, they're going to have a lower nitrogen excretion rate. They could potentially carry more cows if they wanted to, but the likelihood is that they're probably not going to do that. So just band two then, I suppose, as I said, that should actually be 4,501. So it's 4,501 up to 6,500 kgs of milk. You're going to move to the 92 kgs of N per cow. And as I said, that's going to affect a lot of people. Probably 60 to 65% of herds in the country are going to fall into that category. So they're going to go from 89 to 92. So again, keeping the same scenario, 100 cows on 40 hectares that are 2.5 cows to the hectare. Only changes here being that the nitrogen excretion rate has gone up by 3 kgs. And we move to a situation where we're now producing 9,200 kgs of nitrogen per annum on the farm. And when we divide this by our 40 hectare land base declared, we're getting a figure of 230 kgs. So I rounded up the last one, the 223, from 222.5 to be exact. So we're just up 7 kgs of nitrogen per hectare across the 40 hectares, obviously. And we're still in derogation category territory. So dependent on the derogation being retained, obviously, as well. But it's not materially affecting the farm in terms of the numbers of cows that can be carried. Numbers of cows can, or land area that needs to be available for to continue to farm at the level that you're farming. So no major impact in that sense. Band three, however, as I said, is the one that's going to cause the most consternation, I suppose, maybe especially where herds are affected by it, and especially where herds are floating in or around the 6,500 kgs. There are some high output herds, we'd say, that are well up in beyond the 6,500 kgs, and obviously they are where they are. There's no, it is affecting them, but there's very little that they can do. And in reality, I suppose, if we were to look at it, I have heard some people suggesting that more bands would be brought in, but if we bring in more bands, you actually, the higher the milk yield goes, the higher the nitrogen excretion rate is going to go, and as a result, that would actually have a greater detrimental impact for higher output herds. So again, reflecting the same scenario as we've looked at in the other two situations, 100 cows on 40 hectares, only changing from 89 to 106. Obviously, our nitrogen produced on the farm per year is going to increase to 10,600 kgs. When we divide this by our 40 hectare land base, this brings us at 265 kgs of N per hectare. So as I said, Jack Nolan, Bernard Harris and his colleagues are heading to Brussels, or if they're not there potentially already, kind of trying to negotiate the retention of derogation within Ireland for another 4 years. And it's very, very important. Like, we have 7,500 herds, I think 8,000 herds are in derogation currently, and a good 3 to 4, maybe even 5,000 herds that are availing of slurry exports to keep them under the 170. So basically farming over the 170, but using slurry export to stay under the 170. And that is going to obviously be important that we retain that derogation. And it's these adjustments, we'd say, such as increasing nitrogen excretion bands and so forth. We have to do these because Europe are looking for us to do this. And as I said, Chagas have done the figures at the behest of the department to come up with the new figures for it. So as I said, in this scenario, we're going to see a situation where we're going to have to do something in order to get around, or circumvent is probably the wrong way of describing it, but to deal with, I suppose, the adjustment to the cow figure in terms of nitrogen on this farm, on this fictitious farm that we're looking at. So what are those options? I suppose if we just take it, if we're making the assumption that we are going to retain a derogation at 250 kgs of N per hectare in this scenario, so that means that basically when you multiply the land area by 250 kgs per hectare, and you divide it by the 106, it's going to give you the number of cows that you can have. Or else if you divide the number of the actual nitrogen allowance that you have on 40 hectares at 250 by 106, that's going to tell you the land, the area that you're going to need. So extra land in this case is approximately 2.5 hectares required. So an extra 2.5 hectares would have to be declared in order to bring you back in at bang on 250 more or less. So just staying within the limit. A reduction in numbers is the other option. And obviously that there's a suggestion that that might be the preferred option in terms of reducing the cow numbers from an emissions point of view. And that would mean that there'd be 6 less cows on this farm. So only 94.33 technically could be carried on the farm at the current allowances. So obviously we can't have 0.33 of a cow, so we have to take out 6 cows in order to stay within the limit. So we'd be milking 94 cows on this 40 hectare block. The other option is that's available, as I mentioned already, there are quite a number of farms currently using slurry export for various reasons, maybe using tillage ground, exporting slurry to tillage farms. The other option that's coming available in terms of slurry export is maybe anaerobic digesters potentially could be taking slurry from farms, which would be a suitable method of slurry export in line with derogation or with nitrates regulations. And the other thing is then maybe some people have land taken for silage that maybe the owner is declaring for BPS purposes and so forth, but they are taking slurry on an export basis in order to facilitate the growing of crops of silage, etc. So I suppose the other option then, I suppose, it's not applicable to the scenarios that I've shown you here today, but in general, I suppose, if there is going to be an increase in the nitrogen produced by the cow herd, obviously this could cause a knock-on effect on the young stock, which, as I said, I haven't included in the examples here because of the just complexity of trying to go work through the example. And I just want to give you a flavor, I suppose, really, of what's potentially coming down the track at people, rather than getting into the complexities of the scenarios with no stock numbers, etc. That's going to have to be up to people to consult with advisors and work that out on a case-by-case basis. But contract rearing is a potential option where land, like I know definitely down in this area, land in the Munster area, land is quite hard to come by. And it's not going to be a huge option for people to go out and get extra land. And I suppose there are factors that people must bear in mind as well when they're considering these options as well, and touch on it in a second. So contract rearing potentially could offer an option to alleviate the pressures of nitrates on a farm where they are going to kick in with the change of bends, and also have a positive impact in terms of labor on a farm too. So just to summarize, I suppose, for today, the new bends will come into play, and they will come into play soon. I suppose the main thing is that we probably have to figure out, or that we're waiting to see, is when are they actually going to start to kick in. So as I said, the original suggestion is that they'd start to be coming into play from the 1st of January 2022. And as I said, a number of submissions that I have seen so far that have gone in relation to the consultation process around nitrates and the review of nitrates have suggested that this would be more on a phase basis, that there'd be an opportunity given to people to adjust to the new scenario. Second point, I suppose, is that people need to know their position. So I suppose it's a simple enough calculation in reality. I suppose it's cow numbers by the various figures that you see. Do you know what your figure is in terms of milk yield per cow? Sometimes I think people may think that they have higher output than they actually do. But if you divide it by the total number of cows that are on the farm over the course of the year, that's dividing that into the total milk yield sold to your co-op is going to dictate what your figure is going to be. And then I suppose you're going to see, are you going to fall into that band 3 or band 2? And as I said, band 2 is going to have a lesser impact But if you're very close to a 250 limit already with your cone numbers currently, then it could put you into a position where you are going to require extra lend, or maybe that slurry export, as I said, depending on what kind of a lend situation you're in. And then if you are already close to the 250 and you're going to move to the 106, that's going to have a dramatic impact in terms of your nitrates position. So it's important that people establish their position and then I suppose making the right choice for your farm from a labour and an economic perspective. Like land price can be prohibitively expensive around people, and in a lot of cases that's why people haven't maybe taken on extra land and they've stocked up as much as they could on the farm within the current regulations. Now the regulations are changing and people are going to be forced to make a decision here. And as I said, from a labour point of view and economic perspective, you have to do the sums and see, is it justified to actually go take on the extra land? From a labour point of view, if you're already pushed to the absolute limit, maybe to try to manage what you have, taking on extra land that may be away from the block isn't necessarily going to be something that's going to help your situation from a labour point of view. And maybe milking a few less cows potentially could be the right solution for your farm. Now, this is going to vary. There's a lot of farms out there that are going to make very different scenarios. There's a question here. It's the 50 to 60 cow herd stocked high will be put out of business, and that's the reality. I suppose it's a fair point, Tim. I suppose that there's pressure on at all levels. I suppose there are some people probably a little bit more insulated than others. But look, I think it's on a case by case basis. You're going to have to look at the scenarios and see what are the options that are available to people to alleviate the pressures that the nitrates are going to create for people. I'm not saying that it's going to be easy. Obviously, I wouldn't like to diminish anybody's situation or make light of anybody's situation. But it is, unfortunately, a scenario that we are going to have to deal with. So the new bans are going to come into play. And as I said, we have to figure out where we're going to be in regards to those and make the right choices around how we're going to react to the changes. And from there, then I suppose it's going to be a scenario of whether we are going to take on the extra land, whether we're going to reduce the cow numbers. And as I said, it's probably important. I think it's very important that these two elements are factored in. There's no point in necessarily taking on the extra land just in order to continue doing what you're doing if continuing to do what you're doing from an economic perspective isn't making sense. So if you're going out there to pay more land, more money for more land in order to continue to do what you're going to do, is that going to have a detrimental effect on your bottom line overall? And sometimes, and I'm not saying that it's in every case, but in some cases, the right choice will be to actually reduce the cow numbers and reduce the cost associated with running the entire operation possibly. And I know of several cases where farmers have dropped back in numbers, having pushed it to the absolute limit, I suppose, in the absence of quotas, and have actually performed on an equal par from a financial point of view. So it may not necessarily be the absolute detriment of your economic situation. So it's important that people look at it on a whole farm basis and also on a case-by-case basis. So what's good for the goose may not necessarily be good for the gander, and it'll vary from farm to farm, as I said. So just to summarise, new bans will come into play. It's only a matter of case of when. Knowing your position is going to be very important. So what way is it going to affect your farm? And then establishing the right choice for your farm from a labour and an economic perspective. And an economic perspective, I suppose, is the key one that everybody's going to be looking at. Nobody wants to be down money, and I can fully understand why people are looking at it from that perspective. It makes perfect sense. But just bear in mind that it may not necessarily have the negative impact on your economic position that you may think. Okay, so as I said, consult with your advisor in relation to the financial ramifications of any adjustments that may come. And as I said, hopefully we will have time to adjust to these, so it may make things a little bit easier for people to adjust to it in that phase. Okay, so I'll just stop sharing. If anyone wants to ask a question in relation to anything that I've shown there, please do. Type it in there into the Q&A. I suppose just to remind you, just a little bit of housekeeping, as they say, tonight the lads in Grass 10 are doing a webinar, I think it's at 8 o'clock, on managing the last rotation. So I suppose we've gotten to the point where we're just about to start closing farms. Now tomorrow's 1st of October, and in some very high stocked areas, people may already be starting to close, or closing date is very much on people's mind. And lads are just going to go run through with Paddy O'Brien and Hodge Callanan from County Laois, and Paddy's obviously from the Heavy Soils down in Friaries in Kerry, about how they operate their closing strategy and how they kind of think around how they're going to graze their paddocks for the last rotation. I suppose the key thing there is trying to make sure that you're set up for the spring. We've touched on it a couple of weeks ago in relation to identifying the paddocks that you'd like to be grazing in the early part of February, if it's feasible to get out, in terms of access, etc. So the lads are going to go through that. So you can, if you look that up, if you just Google Grass 10 webinar, you'll probably be able to find a registration link for that. It's been floating around on social media there over the last couple of days as well. So we don't have any questions in. Just say we'll wrap it up at that. So as I said, think of your, find out your own position and consult with your advisor from the point of view of the labour and the economic side of things as to how the future is going to be impacted by the changes in those bans. Next week, I'm hoping to talk to somebody in relation to the suggestion of cyst and drift that was spoken about at the open day. And then the following weeks, we'll be doing a good bit in relation to drying off cows around housing, selecting cows using ICBF reports, and also the actual tubing technique. So we'll say bye for now. Wish you all the best for the week ahead. Take care and stay safe. Bye-bye.